voice of Sailor Saturn. Miss Yuko Minaguchi.
Tuxedo Mask. She was my love. Still is. Was. Between two friends. Thank you so much, guys. We're overwhelmed, as I said, at the opening ceremonies. I had no idea it was going to be like this. And wow. And actually, if you guys could do me a big favor, my older brother is here. His name's Kelly. Can everyone say, hi, Kelly?
Hi, Kelly.
Where is Kelly?
He's sitting right over there.
It's all right. It's a brother thing, but guys, thank you for making us feel so welcome, and I'm so excited to spend this weekend with you guys.
My turn. Hi, everybody. I'm John Stalker. Honored and privileged to have started my voice directing career as the voice director of Sailor Moon. It's great to be here. I'm not Sailor Moon. I'm not Tuxedo Mask, so in case any of you were wondering. But I did get to play a pervert. How anime imitates life.
You don't get the name of Stalker for no reason.
Oh, my sides.
What? Okay, well, I guess what we usually do in these kind of panels, if it's okay with you, we just sort of open up the floor because you guys have so many great questions always, and we never know really what we're going to get, which is even better, quite frankly. We may be able to answer, and we may look at you like, no idea what you're talking about. We can't be sure at any given moment. So if anybody has any really great questions, bring it, I say. Let's start it. Anybody have a question? There's one.
Yay!
Oh, they're coming right up to the microphone.
There we go. It always takes one to start. Nobody wants to be first.
So my first question is, when you guys first got the opportunity to do the project for Sailor Moon, did you ever think it would be as big as this?
No, not at all. You know, when we first did this, we had no idea really what Sailor Moon was. And we went in and recorded these things, and a lot of times it was done in piecemeal. We didn't really know what episode we were working on at the time. And we'd walk away thinking, what the heck was that? Like, I threw a rose at somebody, somebody threw a shard of glass at me, Zoysite, and the rest was just kind of like screaming. And then one day, I'm on a streetcar in Toronto, and I see a kid with a Tuxedo Mask backpack. And I actually did call my brother, said, Kel, I said, I see this little guy with a backpack on my character. I go, oh, that's cool. You know, like, no, it's like, it's real. It's like really made, like it wasn't hand drawn. And that was when I realized that this could be something huge. And here we sit 20 years later. I mean, we did the voices when we were 4 years old, right? So, so yeah, this is the thing. And now we get to talk to you and see people try. It's crazy. It's bananas.
But you were probably more the one to ask, I would say.
Yeah, really.
Well, in Japan, Sailor Moon had been a manga before it became the anime, so it was already a big hit in Japan. But I had no idea that it would be such a big worldwide hit. Thank you.
So I've been following Sailor Moon since I was 5, and one of the things that I have at home is I have the Sailor Stars series that was done in Japan, but it never got brought over into America. Were you upset that you never got to do the Sailor Stars season? I know that there was a lot of talk about America not wanting to bring it over due to the fact of the Sailor Stars transforming gender. So what is your thoughts on that?
We've heard a lot of rumors right now that they are going to be bringing it all out again. That said, nobody's talked to us. So there's a pretty good chance, if it's done again here in North America, that it will probably be voiced with a whole new cast in the States, I think. So if any of you are aspiring voice actors, start your... But I would love to see it.
If I might add to it, subsequent to the indecision about whether to bring it over, I believe it is now within a complete.
Really?
Yeah, I've just been getting some emails from some different sources that you know kept me up to date on it, and it's about 99.9% sure that it will be redone. They'll be doing that fifth season first. And then it seems as though they're going to go back to season one and revoice all of them again. So that we will be tossed to the curb.
I don't think so.
I know, I just said that to a listener response.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You can move
the mic. Short people have to address me.
I like staying in my computer. So, a lot of Sailor Moon has a lot of cool gadgets and stuff. All three of you Sailor Scouts here, Sailor Scout too. What would you like to have in real life as well as Sailor Miss?
I missed it. I couldn't hear
properly. Sorry. Because, you know, Sailor Moon has a transformation thing. She has all this, has like a mystifier thing that can change her outfit, the boomerang, the light rod. What's one thing about Sailor Moon which you wish was happening in real life?
Does it matter whether it's their characters or not? Is it any characters?
Any character.
I want a tuxedo.
You know you can rent those.
What?
Yeah.
We'll talk later.
Are you kidding? In a heartbeat, I would take the transformation, please dress me every morning. If I could spindle my arms and twirl around, and my daughters, who are all teenage daughters, would be so happy because my eldest daughter one day said, Mom, I'm not kidding. You were literally the worst dressed person on the planet. Really? She's like, I'm not kidding, Mom. It's disgusting. You are the worst. So if I could spin my arms and spin around, that's what I would take. I definitely say I would use the power to stop time. So I think that would be really useful. Yeah!
I just want to start off by saying that maybe you two and you as well are responsible in a weird way for me finally being here, because Sailor Moon was, for me, the first one. I didn't realize it at the time, but it was the first anime I saw. And what is it like for you knowing that you were part of something that has been kind of a jumping board for many people who come here?
This is sort of all new in a way for me. Last year, for the very first time, I went to a convention. And I had a fan who wrote me on Facebook and said, "Please, will you come to this convention? I'd really like to meet you." And I said, "Oh, well, I don't know. Maybe, I don't know." And I'm thinking in my head, nobody really wants to meet me, so I'd be going to this convention with people not there. And he kept writing to me, said, "Please, please, please, will you go, will you go, will you go?" And finally I said, "Okay, I'll look into it." Meanwhile, thinking in my head, "No, I won't. I'll just be nice to him on here." And then I thought, "Oh, that's lying. Linda, that's not who you are." So I wrote to the people in the convention. I said, "Don't know if you're interested in having me or not. I was a part on an anime show called Sailor Moon." I actually played the part of Sailor Moon. Don't know if you've heard of it, but if you are, now this is me being serious, like literally writing these words. And I'm sure that the organizers went, "Is this a joke?" And then I'm sure they went to IMDb and went, "Oh, Linda Ballantyne, really? Okay, all right." So they wrote back and said, "Yes, we'd be interested in having you." And I was like, "What have I done? Now one guy is going to be standing in this audience and I'm going to be like, I'm an idiot." So immediately I said to them, "I could maybe see if I could get some of the other Sailor Scouts if you're interested." And I write to Katie Griffin. I'm like, "Katie, do you want to do this thing with me, please? Like, I got to leave you alone. She's like, "Sure, I'll go." Whatever. And then she said, "Let me see if Susan wants to go." Susan Roman. Susan's like, "Sure, I'll go. What the heck?" So I'm like, okay. So we get to this hotel, and the weeks leading up to it, I'm like, "What have I done? This is ridiculous. No one's going to care. They're going to be throwing rotten fruit at me. What have I done?" And we get to the hotel, and right away, the cosplay, you know, my little Facebook friend had said, "Oh, and they're really big on cosplay in this one." I'm like, "And what would cosplay be? And how do you pronounce that?" So I get there, you know, he tells me what it is. I'm like, okay. I get there, and immediately, there's like all these beings. And I'm like, this is kind of cool. And I'm in the hotel lobby, and this one woman sees my pass that I'm wearing. That says, you know, guest or something like that, VIP guest. And she walks over and she's, of course, dressed as a cat or something like that. I don't even know, really. And she looks at my badge, and then she looks up at my face. And she looks down at my badge again, and she goes, "Linda Ballantyne, the voice of Sailor Moon. Now I've met two of you. This will be a good con." Watched it as teenagers will have the children with them. And it's like, good parents. Good parenting.
Yeah, I do. I guess I do feel some sense of, like, responsibility somewhere in the back of my mind, knowing that my work has influenced so many people. It does add a certain amount of gravitas.
Good. Thank
you.
Thank you. Just tilt the mic itself.
Sorry. So hi, thank you for coming. I was actually at one of the six or so Sailor Moon panels in the morning, and they were playing some old clips, and I was thinking, I never realized just how silly the audio can get, like made up words and the whole Sailor Sense segment and lots of 90s slang. Did you ever feel like kind of embarrassed to be reading the scripts?
Yeah, no.
Unfortunately, I can't really say anything,
might get killed
too.
Yeah. You don't want her to die, do you?
I'm willing to take the risk. Anybody willing to take the risk?
I'm sure the rest of the fans wouldn't mind if you just killed me so they could all know.
Unfortunately, the best we can do is keep your ears and eyes open.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
I would first like to apologize to everybody in this room. This is only my second con. I'm 30, I'm 29 years old, and I apologize if I can slip up. And two, Tuxedo Mask was my first anime crush.
Syntax, but make it your own, because at the end of the day, I'd have to perform it for, you know, a long time. It was interesting, because it was actually the first role, and I've been acting since I was a little kid, it was the first role that I had fun with, because there is so much weird stuff and interesting lines, and also kind of corny lines too, but what I really liked was that there was a romance in this, and you don't get to see that a lot in animation, at least in mainstream, or anything I've ever done. So to play a love interest, because I mean, I won't be a soap star any day soon. So it was a very cool thing to do. Like, I don't know, it was a very special role. And you know, 20 years later, as I say, I get to sit here and give you a hug and that means something is crazy. And I thank you.
Well, yeah. Thank you very much.
Oh, right back at you.
Thank you so much, guys, for being a huge part of my childhood. Sailor Moon has a lot of meaning to me, but the question I want to ask you guys is, how are you similar to the characters you play on the show?
So to me, that's what Sailor Moon was. She was this, when she was Serena, she's that role of Sailor Moon and be strong and be there for everyone. And so that's what I found in that whole thing. And definitely I am more of the goofy side, I would say. 100% goofy, goofy, goofy. That's what I sort of brought to it, and that's what I wanted that character to be. It's just more fun.
I would say that later on in life, I'm now a father to three. And I have a 5-year-old daughter, 3-year-old daughter, and a 1-year-old son. And the side of protection that Tuxedo Mask always, you know, came to their rescue. I feel like that now, and I'm kind of overlording them. But it's nice to be taller than somebody. Let's just say that. But yeah, that would be, I think, protection. John,
I'm not a pervert. Too much, said Shakespeare. But you know what? Physically, come on. The character wasn't when I acted in Sailor Moon. Before I became the voice director, there was very little connection between me and Grandma. And I guess in terms of being a voice director. And this is not a character thing, but it's interesting that it gives you a different perspective than performing does, if that means anything. In terms of sort of extrapolating that to life, it gives you sort of an inkling into what a greater overview is. We're looking at all kinds of performances and having the obligation of being able to meld everybody's performance and a whole bunch of personalities and make everything work. That's probably helped me a lot in my life in terms of maturing as a human being. Somebody had to be corny.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Serenity. Go!
So my question was, do you have a favorite episode that you voiced and directed? Or else one that was particularly difficult in some way?
I personally have to say that I much preferred the scenes where I was hanging out with Chibiusa and I could just be a regular little girl instead of those scenes where I had to be at home and be like the dutiful daughter kind of thing.
I love being drunk.
My favorite episode is Curse of Clear Destiny, number 30, when they finally...
How does he do that?
Well, it's when they find out each other. It's like, he takes off the mask and she's like, what?
She should not be a detective. Horrible detective skills. But, it was, that was my favorite, because it was also very heartfelt. There were some neat moments in there, but it was also that, the first, like, cool.
Very difficult for me to pick an episode, simply because the way that Sailor Moon was recorded, as was mentioned earlier, was it was all done in bits and pieces. We never really sat down and did an episode. First of all, most animation and dubbing is done in singles. Sometimes it's done with two people, sometimes I would have all four scouts in, but rarely due to scheduling, did I ever have any more than three people in the studio at once? And we would do a bit of episode 11, a bit of episode 15, then we'd go back for a couple of lines that were missing from episode 2, and then there'd be something in 45, then there'd be something in 37 because someone was going to be away or back home in advance. So I never got a handle on a full episode. It was virtually impossible. I think the performers feel kind of the same way. There was never really a flow. It was all done simply to accommodate time and budget, and not necessarily a finished entertainment product.
We didn't get any scripts up front when we were doing it. So we would literally go into the studio and they'd say, okay, Linda, your first line is at 1:42, and it might be, ah! And then you just all of a sudden, like someone's coming to murder me, or oh my gosh, I'm seeing Darian again. So you just start to scream, and you know, like I'd be like, ah, you know, some big scream, and then it would be that I was seeing Darian. I should have been like, ah. Yeah, so it'd be like, okay, go back and do it again. But we would do that, and we would literally just get, maybe in one episode, we wouldn't have that many lines. So they'd do that scream at the beginning, they'd say, okay, now we're gonna go to number 4208, and you'd say, why? And that's all you'd do, you'd just go, why? And then they'd say, great, okay, now we're gonna go to 162, and you'd be like, I wonder why I just said why.
And then lose their voice for the next 30 lines that they've got to do. So you do the dialogue first, and then you go back, and you'll say, okay, there's a scream here, and I yell there, and then you got two lines of arguing here, all of which can impact negatively upon your throat. So again, things out of context make it difficult to understand the flow of an episode.
Of course, the funny thing is, this is my aside, I totally forgot. Of course, when she was recording Saturn's voice, this is still when it was episode by episode for live TV broadcast. So everything in Japan is done in story order, in sequential order, and even within the story, with everyone recording all the voices together in one room.
Oh, that's so
not even in separate recordings. Everyone's lined up.
That's a really, really tough one.
And an episode is roughly about 30 minutes, and split into the first half and second half with the, because there's a commercial breaks and all that, and you record the first 15 minutes, and then the second 15 minutes, all in order of the story.
Wow.
So one must be very quiet when someone else is reading their lines, because you're all in the same room.
Which is hard to do when you're laughing at what they're doing, because sometimes you do that.
Well, actually, I'm actually glad that we did it the way we did, because Linda's very gassy. And that's a later story.
I didn't even need to translate that.
See, also when you're recording, you've got to be so careful. If someone makes a mistake, the way they do it here is obviously different. If someone makes a mistake, you go back and redo the line. If two people are having a dialogue and someone makes a mistake and those lines are overlapped in recording, there's no way to separate them. So now everything's recorded on individual tracks and laid in together later.
But there is something magical when you get to have all the voices together and you get to hear how they're delivering that line. Because like I said, if you're saying the word why, and you don't really know why you're saying the word why, it could be, do you want to go to the store? Why? It could be, you don't love me, do you? Why?
So the only time it was different is if there's a new season or a remake later down the line, and this is not necessarily in relation to Sailor Moon specifically, but there'd be times when, of course, we've moved on to other works, and so the particular episodes that we're filming may have to accommodate that actor or actress's schedule if they need to be called back to re-record a voice. So it's only like really the first run when that's truly possible.
You look great, by the way.
It's okay, Linda. I'm gassy too. Guys, a new fan.
It's funny, my Mini Moon has that very same shirt.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I asked Linda if she calls her kids Mini Moon, and she said she did, so that's cute. So my question for you guys is, I know it's hard for you as voice actors to go back 20 years and remember things like this, but if you can recall one of your favorite lines and say it for us.
for Sailor Moon maybe a braver person and a better person. So thank you so much for changing my life.
Something big. was very cool. It was the second series that I got because I was the voice of Flash Gordon as well in the 90s. And it was, I landed the role of Flash Gordon, and 1 week later I got given a Tuxedo Mask. So for 6 months of my life as a young guy, I would go and report Sailor Moon in the morning and Flash Gordon in the afternoon. And I had no idea what was about to happen and that this would happen. So you never know. And that's like Linda said, if you're meant to do it, go for it. Just tear the head off it. You know, because it's only you who's going to make that decision to go for it. But it is hard sometimes, because like she says, you hear no all the time. You just got to have good friends and good family around you to just say that don't worry, you're still good.
And I think one of the major differences within the voice acting industry right now, in terms of anime between Japan and the US, is that in Japan, some roles, like the role for Usagi, was they knew ahead of time who they wanted. The rest, even it is still audition, but you still have to be hand-picked to audition. And it's from a limited number of people, like 5 or 10 people, they extend the offer to please read for this role. And you don't even read for multiple roles, you read for maybe 2 in the same series. But most of the time, they call you and say, we're thinking of casting you as so-and-so. So, please come in at this day, this time, and read for us.
Almost a direct booking in a way.
Yeah.
And I guess when I was working, doing a lot of things for as a performer for Sailor Moon before I got the voice director for the game, and also I was the guy that would baby 2 lines from the taxi driver, and 4 lines from the baker, and a line for the doctor, and I would come in and do these little 1 and 2 and 3 line bits all over the place, and of course, as you see, the role of Grandpa. I just happened to be recording one day. I walked in, and the producer said, John, would you like to be the new voice director? I fired the old one.
She tends to fire people a lot.
She did fire people, like, on the spot, on occasion. That was her way. I mean, obviously, she came up with a pretty good product, so you can't fault her for it. Especially after I took over. I just happened to be in the right place at the right time. As you know now, I've never voice directed before. I took it on and said yes before I even realized that the pay would be probably the worst pay scale I'd ever worked for in my life. But ultimately, it was certainly worth it. And in terms of advice to an aspiring performer, to go on with what's been said before, don't give up, don't let anyone discourage you, only look for the positive stuff. Anybody that says anything negative about you, just put it in the file, think about it occasionally, because for every positive there are going to be some negatives. But work at it every day. Don't think that just because you've crested one hill that you got it. Realize that when you go out into the world of voice acting, you're not going out and you're not auditioning against a bunch of duds and newbies. You're auditioning against people who have been doing it for years, who are highly skilled, who probably have the upper hand when it comes to getting gigs. You're going to be as good as they are. And that means sometimes, and it differs for everyone because it isn't like a one-room schoolhouse. So the level of your degree of progress is, everyone's degree is different. Work at it every single day. Find a place to get scripts. Read out loud. Listen to animation deliveries and copy them. You're never going to sound like them. As long as you don't go out and go, you're not stealing anything from anybody. If you do that, you'd be sued. But in terms of learning styles and delivering voices and changing your voice, experiment, work, don't stop for even a day. 5 minutes a day, just keep the chops oiled.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi. Regarding the English dub for Sailor Moon, I was wondering if there are any issues maneuvering around the obvious implication of Neptune and Uranus being lesbians.
Hey, we're cousins, don't you know that?
So when we were doing it, I see like this, and all these parts would come up, and I'd be like, they're cousins. They're cousins. They look like they're more than cousins. They're not related. They're cousins? Really? Of course, I'm an idiot, right? I'm just sitting there going, oh, and finally someone said, Linda. Linda. In Japan, they're not cousins. Change, if I was going to change anything about the series now, is I would go back in North America and I would do it the way it was supposed to be done, because people are ready for it now. Yeah. It was revolutionary in Japan.
But that's why it was never implicitly stated in Japan.
Right, it was.
They were together, so they were together. But, like, even in Japan, I mean, Takeuchi-sensei was both a lot of people applauded her for being able to express that in as subtle and yet clear a way as she did.
Well, now, here's my question. I have a question. In Japan, when they were doing Sailor Moon then, because here in North America, really it was geared towards a younger audience. Was it for you in Japan? Was it geared towards a younger audience, or was it, because there was a lot of nudity, which we didn't get.
Well, it was on TV in Japan, so it was okay for pretty much any age range. There's not really that specifically stated a target audience. I mean, certainly when it's DVD releases and stuff, or I guess back then video, they would state a target age range, but with TV, I mean, it was implied that Oh, no, it's definitely fine for young kids to watch. Absolutely.
Follow-up question, completely unrelated. How tall is Toby?
Short. I was constantly losing my voice because I was screaming. I was doing a lot of other voiceovers as well. And I would go in and I said, I'm not doing any more than 4 hours of screaming. I'm not doing any more than four. The other guys had to go in and do 8 hours. Yeah, they would do it. They would do, it was like a factory. They would get as many episodes done in one sitting as they possibly could. So I'd go in there and I'd, like John said, I would say, just save all my screaming and stuff to the end of the day. And, you know, by the end of the day, I'd be walking out. So I'd wake up every morning like, and the way I'd see if my voice, if I could do it, as I go, if I could do that, then I knew that I could get something out. So I'd start the day going, and I'd be walking around the house going, and then finally, exactly, that's exactly what it sounded like. And at the time, my youngest was a year old, and she would toddle along behind me with her little blonde curly hair, she was so cute, and I'd be going, and she'd be going, and I'd say, are you making fun of me? And she'd say, that's why I started calling her Minnie Moon all the time. But Susan Roman actually always says this too in the panels. When you get a voice, when you have a character, you usually have a catchphrase that you use, and that's the phrase that gets you into your character. So for Susan, she always says that her line was something like, I don't know, he kind of always reminds me of my old boyfriend. He kind of reminds me of my old boyfriend. Yeah, and when she says that, she always says that, right? And every time she says that, I go, I don't know, he kind of reminds me of my old boyfriend. And I'm like,
I could do you, Susan.
I could do that. But Toby, that's Toby's one here when he does his meatball head.
Hey, meatball head. I do that, and I know where the voice is. It's like a hook line for me. If I have certain characters, definitely for Tuxedo Mask and Darien, hey, meatballhead, that I immediately know where it is in my kind of palate.
Because it locks it into your system. You've all of a sudden, you know, like whatever muscles had to tense up to get to that, that's where you're starting from. So a lot of times you will use that same line. Like you'll be in the middle of recording or something, you know, like with Susan's line, you know, I don't know, he kind of reminds me. You know, she might say that in the middle of it just to make sure that she's getting right back into character again.
And for me, my advantage to make sure that they stay in character, what I and I think most voice directors do is when you find sort of that quintessential delivery of a particular line from every character, you save it. And you have that line as a reference line. Because performers can drift, they tend to, no matter who they are, no matter how wonderful they are, tend to drift back to their own voice very, very naturally and sometimes imperceptibly. So that by the time you're at from the beginning of the script to the end of the script, it's like, you know, you've drifted, you're off character. Play back the reference line that you've saved, and that goes through the entire series, that same line or two lines, and that gets the performer back on track. Sometimes you have to double back and redo a few lines that have drifted, but that's from my end of things. That's how I work with the performers to ensure that they remain constant in their delivery.
Thank you.
Such a wonderful segue into what I was going to ask, and this is for all of you. Was there a line or a scene, this is for everybody, this is for John, if you're directing one, that you were just in the booth, and you just were having the most difficulty with it, the most, what was your most challenging line or scene to record where you're just like, God.
Believe it or not, for me, it was the, I'm Sailor Moon, and I will punish you, I shall punish you, in the name of the moon. That always got me, because it was such a force, I had to force it out, it was higher than I would normally speak, and when you have to go in a higher register, and then you've got to project it even more. It was always like, oh God, they're going to say it again, aren't they? They're going to make me say it again this episode, aren't they? They're doing it every episode! Come on, people! So that was a hard one for me. I'd see it coming and I'd go, oh no, you're in jokes. Am I going to have a voice today? Things in every episode.
Yeah.
You'd think it would be my hook line.
I guess for me, the most challenging part was all the lines that Mistress Nine had in terms of, especially like the high-pitched like laughing that she had to do that was hard.
That seemed very hard to do.
I had trouble with the screaming. With the, ah! Like, oh! I didn't know. It was very hard because I was also really new to voice acting, and I felt like I had to look a certain way. Like, you forget that it doesn't matter what you look like. And being a young guy, I didn't want to look stupid. So, like, I'd, like, do one take, like, like, that was horrible. And, like, you just got stabbed. Give us something. Like, okay. And so I really had to shed some skin and go for it, but it was the screaming. It was a little weird. But I liked it eventually.
You did it a lot.
I did do it a lot. He was kind
you
of...
got stabbed.
He was sassy.
Well, through my career, I'll tell you, I've had difficulties with a lot of lines, different lines, both commercially and in animation. But it's interesting. I'll pass on that and tell you how I did it as a voice director. Things like what Toby's talking about, part of the job, and I'll make this a little bit of an informative discussion too, part of the job is to get those kind of emotions out of someone who doesn't realize where we're getting stabbed and you go, ah. And I have to stop the proceedings and say, what'd you just do? And I have to say, look, you just had a sword ran through your guts, right? Now, you're not going to go, ah. Or or someone who falls off a cliff, and they go, ah. So now, I guarantee you, if I pushed you out of a fourth-story window, you wouldn't go, ah. You'd go, ah. And that's what I want to hear. So part of my instruction is gutsy, real performance. And you who want to be the voice actor, those are important things to work on. Screams have to sound real. Pain, you get hit in the stomach, you got to hear, not ung. I know it's written ung, but you got to really make that sound. Thank you.
Actually, I'm afraid I'm going to start initiating screams from the audience, but we're actually out of time.
What?
Okay. And much as I'd love to keep going, we do not have the exclusive rights to this room, and there is another panel coming in. So I really apologize to those of you still in queue, but I do want to let you know, everyone on this panel here, I'm sure, has other obligations. I unfortunately only know Ms. Minaguchi's schedule, but I'm happy to report that she'll be back in only 3 hours. At 5 o'clock, she'll have her solo panel just across the hallway in Constitution Room. And actually, if you guys know your schedules, at least for today.
I believe I'm doing a Linda Ballantyne panel tomorrow to talk about myself.
I believe I'm doing a John Stocker panel. I will not talk about any of them at all. I think it's in an hour. Wait, oh, now! It's now!
Really?
Yeah. So, anyone wants to continue discussion with me?
Is it here?
It's in the Constitution. It's over there. I'm getting, these people are great. She's doing, so it's over there. So please, if you've got any questions that you'd like to direct to me, I'd be more than happy.
I have one at 12:30 tomorrow. Maybe.
I think mine's 11:30. And also, we're gonna be in the dealer's room for the whole convention. So you can come on by and you can talk to us. We will happily answer any questions.
Just check your schedules, autograph sessions, everything. They're all in the schedules, so
2 hours.
Just keep your eyes peeled a bit. And thank you.